Happy Frazetta Friday, Frazetta fans. Thank you for joining me on Frazetta Fridays with Frazetta Girls, episode number 3. Tonight we are chatting with my friend, the very talented Stephen E. Gordon. Stephen is an animator, a film director, and a character designer. He has worked on films and series such as Space Jam, A New Legacy, X-Men Evolution, Shrek 2, The Swan Princess, Anastasia, and so many more. He broke into the industry while working on animated films with the one and only Ralph Bakshi, including Cool World, Hey Good Lookin', American Pop, and of course Bakshi's collaborative film with Frank Frazetta, Fire and Ice. Tonight we are going to hear some really fun stories about what it was like working with Ralph Bakshi and Frank Frazetta, among many other things that Stephen shares with us. So without further ado, Stephen E. Gordon.
It's so nice to have you on Frazetta Fridays with Frazetta Girls, episode number 3. So good to see you. How are you doing?
I'm doing great. It's great to be here with you. It's good to see you. I always drew, and you know, I had two older brothers who drew as well. I think there was a certain, and we'd do kind of these comics. You know, we were comic book fans and stuff. We'd read comics all the time, and I started. At one point, we were working on a comic where my older brother would write it and I would draw it, and because I think at some point it became apparent that I had the stronger artistic skills. And I think at one point when I was doing, it might have even been for one of these comics or something, I came up with, for me, which was a brilliant plan, is to pose my G.I. Joe figure and use that as reference.
Yeah.
And you know, and suddenly it was like that immediately made me jump forward, you know, X amount of artistic abilities, you know. And so at some point I just kind of was the one who kept doing the art and stuff. And then through high school, junior high and high school. And then when I was in my senior year, I think it was the first semester of my senior year, my art teacher, who I was working with trying to get my portfolio together, was kind of guiding me and counseling me and whatnot. She came across a trade paper ad, an ad in the trade papers, looking for portfolio submissions. I don't think she even knew what it was for necessarily, but you know, there was like some rendered drawing of some guy or whatever that on the ad, and she thought, oh, this would be good. You'd get a portfolio, a professional portfolio review, and maybe it might show him, poke a few holes in him and make him realize that he's not the end all. Even though I was at the school, which didn't matter much, and she knew that. And unfortunately, she was wrong on both accounts. I didn't get a portfolio review because no one does that. No professional studio or whatever will give you a portfolio review. Either they will hire you or not hire you and give you your portfolio back in those days. Nowadays, it's even easier because they just don't have to answer your email.
But, right.
And since I got the job, it didn't take any air out of my sails or anything. I was able to, still keep my big head for a little bit until I met other artists that he was hiring at the time and realized that I wasn't all that special. But I, the school was great. They allowed me to finish my senior year by going to adult education classes and finish my credits, which I didn't need many more of or anything. And they all worked hard to try to make sure that I still graduated with the class and everything and whatnot, because I think they were pretty impressed because the salary I was getting, which was probably nothing, a couple hundred bucks or whatever, was more than what they were making. So they thought
that's impressive.
They were pretty gung-ho in trying to help me make this work.
What it was like meeting Ralph Bakshi for the first time, and how old were you?
I was 17.
You were 17. Okay.
And I don't, if I recall right, I don't think I met him for several weeks.
Okay.
After I was hired, and it was if I saw him, it was probably only him coming in and talking with the supervisors or over us and stuff, and just kind of, and if you've met Ralph, you know, he kind of comes into a room as a big force.
You know? Yes, big personality.
Yes, he carries the room. So it was very, especially for a 17-year-old kid who, you know, I had the distinct feeling I shouldn't be there. And I was actually trying to give the impression that I was much older.
Okay.
Yeah. You know, and now, as it turns out, that was the right way to go, because he said that if he'd known he was 17, he wouldn't have hired, he'd known I was 17, he would not have hired me. So.
Now, what about the other artists? What were their age ranges?
Oh, they were all in their, you know, at least 10 years older than I was.
Okay.
You know, some many more. I mean, and, you know, and the I was in the first group, because he kept bringing in groups more and more, you know, filling it. And I think initially there were just six or seven of us, or maybe eight, that were brought in initially. And it was, so it wasn't too bad. And it wasn't, you know, I started seeing some of the others, and he kept coming in. He kept every few weeks bringing more and more, because he found the need for him. And this was, you know, back on Lord of the Rings, and we were basically just doing real grunt work on these the orc photos and stuff.
Now, you did the one scene with the rider coming in with the horse, right?
And yeah. Okay. And I happened to be in the right place at the right time. Whenever Ralph got a brilliant idea of wanting to try something new. And initially, I'd run out of work, and one of the animators upstairs needed an assistant. So I was moved into that position for a while. And then Ralph had this enormous scene of those of Aragorn and Gandalf riding on horseback that you're talking about.
Mm-hmm.
Thought that, well, it'd be nice to try to get that done by someone who doesn't cost much. And, you know, and I think at that point,
much of a budget, right? Like, all of his budgets were pretty low with everything.
Oh, yeah, terribly low. But, you know, at that point, he kind of knew who I was. At that point, I've met him, and it kind of taken me under his wing somewhat.
Okay.
And so he had confidence, I think, in me being able to pull it off, because he knew I could draw. And there was very little you could do to screw up that type of a scene. I mean, you could have been screwed up, but, you know.
Yeah, I was going to say that's subjective.
But it took persistence and stuff, and I learned a lot doing it, which is great. But it was just one drawing after another. You know, normally in animation you do, you know, what they call key poses or whatever. You know, drawings one and drawing nine and drawing 17. This one I did 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 all the way through, because A, I didn't know any better, and plus it was such erratic, fast motion. That was pretty much the only way you could pull it off.
So how many days did that, I mean, how many hours would a scene like that take for
boy,
you?
You know, I think I was still assisting the animator in doing that in my spare time in okay. the evenings and stuff, or during lunches and whatnot. So it could have taken me, because I think it was a 100-foot scene, which is unheard of in animation. Especially that complicated the scene.
What does that mean, Steve?
100 feet? Well, it's 90 feet per minute. So it was a little more than a minute, which is a long time for a scene in animation.
And no one realizes how much work goes into that.
Oh, it's a tremendous amount. Yeah. That might have taken me, I don't know, months, I guess, to actually finish it. You know, I don't recall. It just kind of, you know, it seemed like, you know, I remember doing some of the drawing for it, but, you know, my memory doesn't recall exactly how it got done, because I was probably too young and naive to know what I was doing at that point.
Well, it was a while ago.
A few years.
I barely remember anything from last year. So asking you tough questions. But yeah. So after you worked on Lord of the Rings, what film did you work on with Ralph Bakshi?
Then I worked, I believe it was Hey Good Looking or American Pop.
Okay.
And I'd have to get out the my IMDb page to know for sure. Yeah. But those films came before. On American Pop, it was essentially the same sort of idea as Lord of the Rings, which is the rotoscoping, except, you know, because I, at that point, wasn't interested in doing straight on rotoscoping. I ended up getting a lot of the broader characters and the stuff that didn't matter if I was off roto. You know, I was allowed to exaggerate and stuff. So, you know, I ended up doing Jimi Hendrix in that, and a lot of the musical numbers and stuff.
Now, so, why didn't you want to do the roto? Was it just the...
Well, I just found it very difficult for me to... I mean, on that film especially, Lord of the Rings, it was kind of broader rotoscope, mm-hmm. more reference. But other than the 100-foot scene I did. But on American Pop, for whatever reason, he decided that he wanted it to be like slavishly right on the live action. And that just was not what I was comfortable doing. You know, I tried it a few times, but I kept kind of still, like, if someone yelling, suddenly their mouth got bigger and more defined. And, you know, I kind of pushed things, even at that age. And that few years in the industry, I was still already kind of pushing things.
Yeah.
But what it did was it gave him an idea of when he did finally do Fire and Ice, hooked up with your grandfather, that I was probably a good choice for that, because I wasn't going to just make it look super realistic. I was going to make it exaggerated and pushed and stuff. So,
yeah. Now, so you were the director of animation.
I was the animation director, supervisor, whatever.
Mm-hmm. Now, how did that just kind of come about because of Ralph and your relationship? And he just was like, you're the perfect person for the job, or?
Well, I would like to think that's what it was.
Yeah.
For all I know, maybe I was the 10th person he called. I don't know.
Ah.
I was there. But, you know, I was at that point, I was working at Filmation, you know, where I met my wife. Not my wife then, at that point, obviously. But
is she back there? Is she in the studio with you?
Yeah, she is. She's sitting in the corner.
Hello? But
she's hot.
Oh. She's like...
She's waving. Anyway, so I was working at Filmation. I was doing character layout. There was no character layout. It was layout on Lone Ranger and some of those types of shows like Tarzan and Zorro and whatnot. And, you know, as a sharing an office with Dave Stevens, you know, he is, right?
Yes.
Yeah, the Rocketeer and Russ Heath. Anyway, so that was a great time to, you know, begin to work with him. And then I got a call from Ralph, and he offered me the job to be the animation director on Fire and Ice. And so that was quite exciting.
So you guys started that, and it came out in 83. It started in like in 80. Did it take about a year to...
Yeah, it probably took about a year. I mean, I was there a little earlier because initially when he was getting the studio up and going in Sutherland, he started off doing some shorts and stuff, some anti-smoking shorts and some junk shorts or whatever, just to kind of get a feel for the studio and stuff and to kind of get people in place and keep us busy for a little bit. Well, he's probably still negotiating with your grandfather and stuff.
Yeah, so. I think they went back and forth quite a bit.
Oh, I don't doubt it. Yeah.
Those two working together. I mean, I remember going in my grandpa's studio, and I mean, this was well after the film in the 90s, and Ralph and my grandfather, the way that they would go back and forth with each other and just both so loud. My grandpa would always just say to him, "You're so loud, Ralph. You're so loud."
Yeah.
But they had that kind of relationship. They were bickering, but like brothers. Like, they loved each other, but they liked to pick on each other quite a bit about everything.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah, they had a weird yin and yang thing going on.
Yes.
They definitely got along real well, at least as far as I could tell. But it was a very strange chemistry going on there. So
it shouldn't have worked, but it worked, kind of. Chemistry. It's definitely strange. I think like the Brooklyn factor kept them together.
I wouldn't doubt it. Yeah.
I
have no doubt that same humble beginnings and that type of stuff and the East Coast and stuff.
So when you were there working, I mean, was your like head down all the time, like back in like, what was it like being there working on that?
Yeah, I had a ton of work that I had to do, because I not only was I animation director, I was keying every scene for everyone else. Other than, the only scenes that I didn't key were the Tigra scenes, because that was at that point in my artistic development. It was a little bit further in a direction that I wasn't quite comfortable with. And so we hired someone else to help with that. We went through a lot of people before we finally found the Tigra keyer. But every scene, you know, had to have key drawings in it, anywhere from one to a dozen or so, depending on the length of the scenes. And I was doing all the male characters. I think there's very few that I didn't do.
I saw a lot of your Larn drawings, actually, with the costume and everything. Yeah. I didn't realize, I should realize, but I didn't realize actually how much work goes into creating the character.
Oh, yeah, really. Yeah.
It's intense.
Yeah, Frank would basically come up with the concept and the drawing and a pretty drawing of the character or whatever. Mm-hmm. And then I would have to kind of turn those into model sheets and, you know, and show how it worked on top of the actor and such. You know, the rotoscope live action scene, do a comparison. I think I've shown you those drawings.
Yeah. And you said, you told me before that they had a hard time finding the model, the actors, right?
I mean, well, especially the Tigra actor. Yeah. Actress. Yeah.
They
went
through
a lot. Yeah. Yeah. I mean, they didn't, they had a lot of trouble finding someone that fit that figure, obviously. And they never really did. So I think at some, and they looked at a ton of young actresses and stuff, and most of them probably weren't so much good actresses, that they just look good in bikinis or out of bikinis or whatever. So
I guess we'll skip over that part. But
okay, yeah. I'm not sure who your audience is.
I don't know the guidelines of YouTube. I need to look into that more, of what I can and cannot say. But I read an interview, and my grandpa, but this was like a later interview, and you know, he had the health problems. Mm-hmm. But was it true Heather Locklear came through?
Not that I'm aware of, no.
Okay. I thought that might be a little bit, I'm like, maybe he's, maybe.
If she did, she never made it to photograph her, because they would take pictures of a lot of these girls, mm-hmm. you know, in their bikini or whatnot, and they would give a copy of it to me, and I would try to draw a line around it to see what it would look like. Mm. And if she was in that group, I sure did not see her.
Yeah.
And they ended up using what was one of the better actresses, I guess, that came through.
Cynthia Leek.
Yes.
Right? Yeah.
And I think she was in maybe soap operas at the time, or she had actually some screen credits, whereas most of the girls that came through did not. You know, some of them were strippers, or some of them were athletes, or some of them were models.
No wonder my grandpa didn't want to leave California.
I think he had a great time. I'm sure him and Ralph would lock themselves in his offices during casting. And
yeah. He's like, this is the best part of the job, guys. I'm going to be in the casting room for.
Yeah, I'm sure.
he's like firing the actors just so he can rehire them again.
That's
and
right.
do it. You know, it was funny. I saw a picture of Larn, the live action Larn, and. Mm-hmm. He looked more like a Frazetta girl than Cynthia.
Yeah.
You know, he had the characteristics of like the tiny little nose, and I was like, huh. I'm like, that's an interesting discovery.
Yeah, no, he was not a Conan type by any means.
No, he was like a real pretty boy.
Yeah,
and,
he was.
Yeah.
I think they mainly cast him because he was athletic. Stuff.
Okay. So like a gymnast type
guy.
Yeah,
I think he was a gymnast, if I recall right. And, you know, that's who they kind of needed. And they, I think they tried using his voice, and it was not very good. They ended up having someone, an actual voice actor.
Well, they ended up doing that with everyone, right? Because Maggie Rothwell did Tigra's voice.
Right, eventually they replaced her, Cynthia Leek's voice too. But, you know, there are a couple of them, I think, stayed. I think the one playing
Necron.
Necron, John. Thank you. I blanked for a minute. Yes, Necron. In fact, I think he either did the voice of Lauren or the guy playing Tigra's brother did. I can't recall right. It's one of the two.
I should know this too. I'm also blanking. Sorry, Sean. We love you. We had that fire and ice reunion, Steve. That was so
Yeah, up in Florida. Yeah.
Yeah, that was at the Shock Pop Comic Con, the one and done show.
Yeah, they ended up paying half the people.
That wasn't good. You kind of had that sense that it wasn't going well when you were there. You're like, oh.
Yeah, I mean, having a stage in the middle of a. The exhibit floor probably was not the best way to handle it.
Do you remember we had some audio issues in the beginning? It was like that times 10. Remember, I think Robert Rodriguez called in and couldn't really hear him. And I'm like, what? This could have been so good.
Yeah.
I mean, we had all of us together.
And Ralph and Rodriguez was on the on screens, two separate screens. And I don't think they could hear each other.
But, you know, I guess playing devil's advocate with my technical difficulties, it's harder than it looks. It's like, oh my God, this is challenging. I do want to bring up a picture.
Those days. I mean, how long ago was that? That must have been 10
I don't know. I just looked at the picture of myself and I'm like, I look quite younger. So I think it was 2015, yeah, 7 years ago.
I'd have to look because I know I took my daughter. And, it was the first year because she was big into American Horror Show or whatever that show
American
was.
Horror Story.
Yeah. And one of the actresses from that was there and she was thrilled to death. So it would be probably whenever that first year of that show was, I guess.
I completely forgot about that. And now I can't even remember the actresses. It's so weird how our memories I'll remember like every negative thing, but like the positive fun thing. So I'm like, why? I guess it's a survival thing. I wanted to pull up this picture real quick, Stephen. Look at this.
Yeah, look how young I am.
Now tell me about you're still so handsome. So look at the Frazetta drawings on the back. Like, I mean, what was going on right here?
Well, that was my office, and Frank had sat down to try to do some drawing at my desk. And tell us what he was doing. And he was not very good at actually describing what he was doing. I don't think he'd ever thought about it before. Because, you know, it just kind of came out of him. I don't think he ever spent time, you know, trying to figure out what is it he did.
He couldn't articulate it very well, ever.
Especially when it came to Frazetta Girls.
When he would talk about even how he'd say, well, I just tell him how to move and just do like a little va-voom. And I'm like, well, what does that mean?
it's hard to say exactly. I mean, there was probably a little bit of that going on, but the way Ralph shot it, it was like he shot the live action at such a high rate of speed because there was no background or sets that had to be moved around other than, you know, ramps and scaffolding and stuff like that that he substituted. So there wasn't a lot going on the set, and he just shot multiple setups a day, like sometimes 100 setups, I believe, which is unheard of. You know, in real live action, you shoot maybe two or three a day or four, you know, and he was just banging through them. So I don't know that there's a lot of time for Frank to have shown people how to necessarily walk or act, or, you know, other than brief moments of, here, try it this way, or, you know, this is the better attitude and stuff.
Yeah. So. Yeah, he wasn't on set very often. It was just...
when he was, and you'd see him in the photographs.
Right.
A lot. He always had his camera. Usually standing behind Cynthia, you know, crawling through a log or something.
He's such an interesting human being.
Sure.
To learn about now, like as I'm learning about him as a just not grandpa, but like Frank Frazetta,
must be hard to kind of put the two things together for you.
Yeah, I mean, in hindsight, then things makes more sense. I'm like, oh, okay, he was just very eccentric. He's a very eccentric person, and I know a lot of people don't like to ever criticize Frank Frazetta because he's, you know, he's legendary, but I do imagine that working with him would have been somewhat difficult just because of, again, how you like just said, how he communicated and just his.
It worked pretty well. I mean, most of his time was spent with the background artists because that was essential. And he, something he could actually understand too. I mean, he didn't know animation, obviously, but he understood painting. And that's what they were doing for the backgrounds. You know, it was James Gurney from Dinotopia and Thomas Kincaid from that junk, you know, from the painter of light stuff or whatever.
Yeah, the light. But,
you know, they'd just gotten out of art school and stuff. And, you know, they were 90% capturing his look a lot, especially James. James really got it heavy.
And James is, I mean, just so incredible. Everything he's done. Mm-hmm. He's just, I really just love his style. And he has such a like otherworldly creative imagination with the landscapes and Dinotopia. I mean, he's a wizard. I actually crossed paths with him, but I didn't realize it was him. He was at the Norman Rockwell fantasy exhibit that I went to last summer. And I was just like, who's the crazy person in the top hat?
He does have an exhibitionist side to him, I guess.
And I didn't get a chance to talk to him. We got a picture together in like the group, but I didn't get a chance to talk to him. And I was so mad. I'm like, because I wanted to talk to him about like what it was like working on the background. So I wanted to pull up this. So you shared on you. Well, Steve, I have to say you've helped me tremendously when I've made posts before about like what the rotoscoping is. You've so graciously corrected me in the sweetest way possible.
Oh, good. I'm glad it wasn't obnoxious.
No. You're like, let me fill you in a little bit more about actually what rotoscoping is. And I told you that I had pulled a lot of my sourcing from these magazines that also didn't have a clue.
Yeah, some of those magazines were clueless.
That's a cell, okay.
Yeah, celluloid cell or whatever you want to call it. And basically, the way it's created is the animator would draw on paper the drawing, the black and white drawing, the line drawing, and then it would get Xeroxed onto a cell.
What is a cell? Like just like
it's a film? Piece of plastic.
Okay.
It's a special density plastic or whatever. I mean, I'm sure there's all types of different, you know, weights and stuff, and it would get put on cell, and then painters would come in and flip it over and paint the back of it. That way the line would be on the front and the back, the color would be behind it and stuff. And you know, there'd be tons and tons of those for every scene and stuff. So
I'm trying to wrap my head around this, but like, would you guys ever have like any like horror like days where you're like missing one cell and that?
The studio could get torn apart when something went missing or a scene went missing, or I mean, there's all types of things that happen during a production that is crazy. You know, sometimes, you know, I mean, it could happen. There's all the departments, as they can paint, the Xeroxing, there's, you know, animation, there's in-betweening, it's amazing how many different problems can occur during the day, which is probably what drives people like Ralph nuts, you know.
Putting out fires.
Constantly.
Yeah,
it's just crazy, and that's why, you know, often you would, you know, have explosive moments and start, you know, I could imagine, especially on a tight budget like these things. I mean, Fire and Ice, I think, was done for a couple million at best.
I have another one. So you worked on this one as well, right?
Another cell of Rolio. I forget.
Thank you for bringing up her name, because I still can't. I couldn't like figure out how to pronounce it. I'm like reading it, and I'm like, this is Rolio.
Well, it's been a while, obviously. Yeah. But it's something I know. I can see it in my head, and I can kind of vaguely hear it. But.
Yeah, R O L I E L. I can spell it, but I can't say it for the life of me.
Yeah, so I mean that was a great character. I mean, people love that sequence, weirdly enough, and I ended up animating the entire thing of her when she got brought back.
And, did you? You animated all of that? I loved that.
Yeah, I did the Larn, and I did her, and I look at it and think, boy, I wish I could get another crack at that and make it better. But you know, but people seem to
maybe you will.
Yeah, well, be wonderful. but at that point, I was, even though I was the animation director, I was really pretty green. I was probably 21, 22 or something like that. So I was using whatever tricks I could figure out.
And, right.
Yeah, and there are a lot of clunky things that happened on that sequence. But, you know, overall, everyone seems to love it. So, okay.
It's a great sequence. And I will tell you, like, we've been, you know, we're working, you know, and hopefully the audience knows, we are working on reviving Fire and Ice for its 40th anniversary, 2023. Mm-hmm. And that's
already.
I know. I was like, oh, that hurts. But whatever, you know, we should embrace that we're still here and not say, oh, we're old. It's like, no, we're still here. This is pretty great. So we're working on reviving the property. And we're working on a prequel as a comic series and a sequel as a role-playing game. I can't obviously give out too much information now, but I will tell you that when we were talking about this internally, that sequence, that animation part with Roleal.
Maybe, yeah.
Roleal. That's the easiest for me when I say Roleal, that works. So we're going to go with that. So
go with it. Good.
But she keeps coming up. Everyone creative is like, but this, you know, what is she? Like, what's going on? Like, we need to figure her out. So
yeah, what's that with her son? What's the deal?
Just so proud. Yeah. He was so proud that he was part of something and could bring the essence of his artwork into a medium that he loved so much, which was film. And it's really unfortunate that his illness took over, God, only a few years later. That's when he had the undiagnosed thyroid issues, and I thought he was insane, but it turned out to be hyperthyroid, and you kind of do go insane when your thyroid's
on. I bet, yeah.
Yeah, he like went down to like 125, but he was really adamant. I mean, the interviews I've read about him and, you know, I think from what we talked about earlier, him having a little bit too much fun with Ralph in the casting room. I think that's what prompted my grandma to say, Frank, you're done with California and you're coming back to Pennsylvania to the, you know, 70 acres of land where you're not going to see a woman anywhere. So she ended up trapping him in a way, but yeah.
You're going to stay in the swamp.
yeah. You're going to go look at the lake and look at some moss, but no more. Let me check your film, what you were taking pictures of out there.
Now, I remember when, even in California, he was talking about that, the land that he had, talking about how the only way you could keep the mosquitoes away was by smoking cigars and stuff. So
mosquitoes. I guess I've been out of Pennsylvania for a long time now, but
well, maybe on the land where he was, because I think initially it was kind of swampy there or something, at least the way he described it.
It was swampy. You know, as like a kid, I feel like memories are just your how you perceive is so much different. It's like magical, and then as you're an adult, you notice things that are just more annoying. You're like, this isn't magical.
this is a pain. Now, if I recall right, he said, I think he was talking about they had some sort of pond or lake built or, you know, dug.
That is true. Yeah. Yes. Okay. I don't know why. I mean, the lake was like disgusting. It was just like this like mud pit, and like you'd imagine that something like a Frazetta weird creature would come out of that lake.
Yeah.
You wouldn't want to eat a fish, I'll put it that way, that came out of that lake.
No fishing in the fishing hole.
Yeah, it was like I don't know, like radioactive. It's so you've been what have you been working on now, Steven? I know you've been busy.
X-Men. Yeah, I'm right now I'm doing some work for Marvel Animation that I can't talk about, the, you know, penalty of death.
Yep. Yeah. No, you never.
And I'm doing some other stuff for Disney Plus, and which I can't talk about because they haven't announced that either, And I'm also just started a comic that I'd started for a comic company that imploded a while ago based on Werewolf in Paris. an old pulp novel. I think it was like the first werewolf novel.
Okay.
Back in the pulp days or whatever. The guy that I started it with just came up, found a publisher, and he said, you know, we could go finish this. Now that, you know, I had like six pages roughed out, six or maybe, you know, maybe it was a dozen pages or something. And he said, you know, we could go finish this if you want to. And I said, yeah, I'd love to, you know, do it as a graphic novel. So that's kind of what I'm doing in some of my spare time right now, as well as other miscellaneous junk. But yeah.
Oh, that's awesome. Are you enjoying that? Kind of like that?
Oh, yeah. Yeah. I mean, it's fun. I mean, it kind of hits the right. Hey, it's, you know, very Bernie Wrightson, Frazetta type of story. And, you know, it's all period. It's all in the 1800s or whatever after I can't think of the war, some war in France or whatever. You know, it takes place during that and stuff. So it's all kind of fun. A lot of research that I have to do to get costumes.
I was going
to
ask you. Yeah. So is that when you're doing your creative process, like when you're going into it, do you start with research or do you kind of just add research in as you're going?
It depends. A lot of times I will, especially at the beginning of this one, I'd never heard of that war or anything else. I wanted to kind of get a feel for what the soldiers looked like and, you know, the costuming, of course, for the main characters and stuff, because I thought that would lend its unique look too, obviously, you know, as opposed to everyone just looking like, you know, they just stepped off of a Hollywood set or something, you know.
Right, right.
Back in the days when the universe was doing monster movies, they just, you know, whatever was contemporary clothing in those days was used,
it's just, again, like going back to how much work it really takes, the behind the scenes of in the life of an artist, it's like, it's grueling.
Making a living doing comics full time and stuff like that would be, and unfortunately they don't often pay well, so it's a
no. If I have a chance to ever be involved with the finance part of projects, I just hope that I can be blessed enough to change that in my small world, because that's like the one thing that kills me. I'm like, oh my God, the artists are getting paid or the writers are getting paid this much for this work. It's not, but I get it. It's with budget constraints and.
Oh yeah. And you have to figure out the profit margin and everything else.
Exactly.
Yeah. And you know, even, you know, Frank had to deal with all that when he was first starting out in comics and then even when he was doing paperback covers and stuff. Yeah. I mean,
well, most of his life, he didn't have money. I mean, the $1 million painting happened right before he passed away. And he was just like, great. Like, because I think as like an artist, he was just so used to living on basically nothing.
Yeah. And going hand to mouth and, you know, we're running out of money. I better do another painting. You know.
Well, and then that was because my grandma. I think he would have just left. You know, whatever. He would have just been like, I don't. Maybe like in a shed. Like I think he would have been content with basically nothing. But because he had a family, that wasn't an option.
No.
I think. I mean, God, even like the Lancer paperbacks, and that was what really got him on the Conan work. And
sure.
It was a really low number. Like they paid him nothing. And it was the only ones that paid were the, from what I recall is the movie posters. They paid him pretty well.
Yeah. And that was kind of an established art form and movies made more money in theory they could. And so, there's kind of a price guide as to what people would make on those. So I'm sure he must've loved doing those, even though, I know. I understand he wasn't real thrilled with having to do all those caricature posters and the 30 or 40 characters running after them, something or you know.
Yeah, he did not enjoy doing those whatsoever. It was just I'm pretty sure at that time my grandma saying you better make
you
money
need to do this. Yeah,
yeah.
On the other, I mean, she was the one who made sure they got a lot of the art back, which is great. I mean, otherwise,
it's weird though. So I my whole life I had heard that it was all my grandma's doing, but then with his work with EC, it was the Weird Fantasy 29, I know he was the Buck Rogers. It was one of the last ones that got rejected. And he was not with my grandma at this time. And he was the one that was like, I really want to keep this painting, this original. And he was really pushing for it. So I think that it was just a matter for him. It was like if he was really passionate about the piece, like he would push for it. And I think my grandma saw it obviously as a business, and she saw like, yeah. Oh, we're gonna bring people to the museum, and we're gonna tell them nothing's for sale. And but of course everything is for a price. And
yeah, sure.
but my grandpa, I just read it was about his last comic work, his Creepy Number One. And the werewolf story, speaking of
right,
werewolf.
Okay, yeah.
So when he was talking about that, and it was actually, he was talking to Dave Winowitz, and he was like really angry that my grandma and his son, Frank Jr., were selling those panels. And he was like, you know, they split it up, the work, the whole story, and now they're selling panels from it. So there were certain pieces, it was, you know, I don't know, they're like, it's a marriage, there's complications.
Yeah,
It's a business partnership in a marriage, which makes it even more complicated. But I think my grandpa's whole thing was just, it was truly what he was passionate about. And then he'd fight to keep it. And then, you know, but who knows?
That makes sense. Yeah. I mean, there are certain pieces that he probably loved and wanted to keep. And probably that triggered your grandmother figuring out, this might actually be the way to make money down the line. I mean, she actually could see the complete future, but she understood that if they hung on to these, there might be a secondary market down the line.
Oh, yeah. I mean, even with the merchandising, I mean, my grandpa never would have done that. I mean, the fact that the posters, she made like 100,000 reproductions of the posters for like 20 cents a piece, like each poster. We still have those vintage posters. I think I'll have some of them at least until I'm dead. They just keep going. But they were sitting in the basement from, I think they printed them in the like late 70s. And then she got into the calendars and the statues. And, you know, my grandpa would just look at it and go, oh, whatever. I don't care. Do whatever you want. I'm just going to go take some.
I'm going to go repaint something.
Yeah, I'm going to go take something off the wall from the museum and really piss off Ellie and his fans. And you know, it's crazy when he did those repaints. I'm sure you know this, but most of it was because he didn't have another canvas to work on because he just didn't want to spend the few dollars to buy another canvas. And I'm like, what? That's where I wish I could have the talk, like just a real conversation with my grandma and say, why? And
I know like a stack of canvases.
Why didn't for Christmas someone just get grandpa like a whole room of canvases or masonite board or anything he wanted? Why wasn't that like, why didn't I do it as a child? Why didn't that sink in? I don't know.
Yeah, it's crazy. I mean, you hear stories. I mean, and you know, he always kind of, his work materials were always the cheapest things he could find, I gather, which is what caused his problems later.
Yes.
Down
the line. That
linseed oil and stuff.
You wouldn't ventilate, Stevie. You're an artist. And can you imagine not ventilating at all? If I smell like bleach or any kind of paint fume, I'm like, whew.
But it must have been so in his system that he probably couldn't even tell any longer.
Well, the last time right before his major his Graves disease, he said he like tasted death. Like he kept like talking about it. He's like, I just tasted something weird. I tasted death. Like it was in my throat, and I couldn't smell anything but death. Like going back to how he couldn't really describe things very well. It was just his world, his perception. So he said that it was, and maybe that was all like the toxins just sitting in his.
It could be. I mean, he was probably getting high in that room.
Yeah, you know, he was very straight edge when it came to he didn't do drugs, he didn't drink alcohol, but he definitely got high on linseed oil.
I mean, you're not getting any ventilation. That just the smell probably would have. Oh man.
Yeah, any artists watching, don't smell linseed oil to make something like Frank Frazetta.
Yeah.
So, Steve, speaking of art, I wanted to ask you about this piece. I love this piece that you did. Is this a commission?
No, that was, I did that for that convention we were talking about. I did a series of those.
You did?
Just for that convention. You know, there was this, and there was the one of Larn and Tigra, and then one of Dark Wolf, I think, and Necron and his mother.
Do you have the whole series up on your Facebook still?
Maybe not on Facebook, but on my website probably.
Let's tell everyone where to find you. StephenEGordon.com. Is that correct?
Yeah. StephenEGordon.com with a V. Make sure you remember the middle E after Stephen. Yes.
Yeah, because you have a really nice website, by the way. I have to tell you. Like, I love the chronological order of your career. If I had a better memory, I would have been able to recall all of those things. Did my research and then I forget, but you know.
I forget all the time, don't worry.
Yeah, I feel better about that because you're like, I don't really remember. But no, I really love that piece because it's Steven. I feel Steven in the characters. And
yeah, it's not, I mean, obviously it's not Frank. It's my version of them.
Yeah.
It's not even what I drew probably when I was working on the show. And I said, I rarely did Tigra. So, I mean, that was.
Well, you did her great there.
I think she turned out okay. But, you know, they had to have someone specifically anchored onto her because that was the main concern of the film. So.
Yeah. Tigra, I mean, it's. And that's kind of like creatively right now with working with this revival, that's our biggest concern. And I guess I'm like my grandfather in that way. I'm like, Tigra, we have to get Tigra a certain way.
Right. Yeah.
Well, and I think like with the double entendre, you know, the Frazetta girls, my grandpa coined the term Frazetta girls. And then we took that because it was like I said, a double entendre. We're his girls. And
you were the Frazetta's girls. And yeah, sure.
Yeah. It worked. So with what I am doing day to day, there's just such an emphasis on his girls, and like Tigra is the Frazetta girl. So it's a big task for any artist trying to nail.
Yeah. Tigra. Oh yeah. I mean, I'd say a good percentage of his time on the film was spent working, trying to get that girl. I mean, Tigra downright, and the girl that we eventually hired to do it, she spent a lot of time with him. Going back and forth, not just trying to get, you know, the drawing right, but get the face right and get the proportions right. Because, you know, Frank hadn't even thought much about breast size or anything else. Because he'd just paint whatever felt right in that painting.
Right.
And then, you know, one day he'd come in and say, you know, I think each breast should be the size of her head. And then the next, and you know, and then the next day he'd come in, no. Both breasts together, you know, it's just he'd contradict himself constantly because I don't think he ever gave it any serious thought. It was just whatever came out of his paintbrush was a Frazetta girl or ink pen or whatever. But to actually have to try to describe it to someone who, and we needed to keep consistency,
put
it on a model and make sure it was something that could be followed. That was probably one of the harder things for him, is trying to figure out what a Frazetta girl was.
So. I think that was just his overall personality too, like contradicting. I mean, I talked to like certain just Frazetta historians and people worked with him on books and they always say the same thing, that he was full of contradictions. Like his story would a few years later with an interview would contradict something he said. I think it was just who Frank was, very eccentric and.
Yeah. And I think he enjoyed mythologizing about himself and this sounds really good. I have a photographic memory, but
yes, which we've proven to not be true.
And you do that. You've got the best photographic memory.
yeah. Well, I mean, he had with his references. I mean, he had a mirror next to his.
Oh sure, how many cameras does a man have to own before you realize he's using camera footage, snapshots and stuff.
They all look like him. So, yeah, I mean, naturally. Sure. Yeah. And he was, you know, he prided himself on being able to just have that athleticism and get into those poses. And you see those poses and you're like, that's Frank. Like,
that was the whole way. I mean, the Al Williamson and Roy Cranko and all those guys that he grew up in the with as artists and stuff, that's how they all worked. They all took photographs of each other.
Right.
I mean, Yeah.
Well, do you, I mean, what do you use references?
Sure. Absolutely.
Yeah. So I mean,
I've got, not only do I use photos and stuff, but I've got, you know, posable models and, you know, dolls and stuff that I use if I need to. And
I don't know how you would work without a reference. I mean, I dabble in drawing and when I try to close my eyes and visualize something, I see nothing.
I mean, you have to have an idea of what you want to do, but
right.
I use photos a lot and by Google and, you know, the fact that I'm friends with a lot of cosplayers and stuff, you know, I utilize their photos and whatnot. And, yeah.
Oh, we're so lucky with what we have now and our access on, I mean, that's what inspires me. Just like Instagram models. And I'm like, wow, like there's this one girl, I think you've seen me post her quite a bit, Baby K.
She's a Frazetta figure. Yeah.
Oh God. It's like amazing. She inspires me to want to draw a human body. I'm like, that's.
Yeah, I mean, you get that a lot. Yeah. You know, artists do, they see something, go, I want to draw that, or I want to paint that.
But no, Stephen, thank you so much for your time tonight. Seriously. I love chatting with you. I love learning from you. And I just want to thank you for being here and sharing some stories. And will you come back someday, like in the future? We can when we work together, because we're going to be
absolutely.
Working.
Anytime you call me, we'll figure out a time.